to 10:15 for another evening of facts and fun, hopefully. So before we get started, we'd just like to know how many of you took a cold shower?
Oh!
I'm impressed.
So, cold is a relative term. You can adjust it. Now, where Dick and I used to work, the control panels were outside the shower.
Yes.
The attendant ran the controls, and the person inside had no say on those. Okay? When you can control it, it's not even, you just gradually work into it over a week or two, a couple weeks, and then get it colder and colder as you shut it off. But the first one I ever had was in a big, huge, like, it's the size of like a YMCA shower. The guy was even hosing my back.
Okay,
it's like a big time torture chamber.
Yeah.
It's to boost the immune system.
Yeah.
Okay, and so, and he was running the control valves. And first thing he says to me when I get in there, he says, "You a weightlifter?" And I could see him go, "I'll get this guy." So anyway, when you can control the panel or the valve, it's easier, better.
Yeah. People like to make weightlifters beg for mercy for some reason. I don't know what it is. But yeah, the center, we hit them with 8 different shower heads in a confined environment. I mean, you couldn't get out, so.
Yeah.
But they always felt very invigorating. How many of you felt like you really picked up some valuable information last night?
Oh, yes.
Okay. You didn't put your hand up, so what? We had fun. You know, this really is our passion. You know, both you probably tell Jay and I enjoy doing this very much. And so we appreciate you all coming out. And so at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Professor Sutliff as he starts on one of his favorite topics.
Okay. Well, what we're going to look at is, how many of you did not get here last night? So we have a couple new people in the back. Okay, great. Okay, so this is the basis of what we're doing. There's many ways to teach health principles and things like that. We're taking more of what's called a systems approach, where you take different systems in the body and then you try to put it together with the idea that we don't want to work in isolation of any one system, because your cardiovascular system ties into your muscular system and so forth. So those types of things. And so what we see here is really the basis of this is by preserving the vigor of every organ in the body. Okay? So we're thinking every organ, we'll experience optimum health, which is our little phrase, optimize for life, and guard against disease. So we're looking at optimizing health, and then in doing that, we guard against disease. Okay? So last night we talked a little bit about skeletal system. You want to touch on that? Just for some of you that weren't here, just maybe a couple things?
Yeah, I can. One thing I do want to mention, optimize for life is actually the name of our online health ministry that we're doing, and you can find us at optimizeforlife.org on the internet, and we actually do have lots of other videos on there from lectures from Jay and myself, exercise programs, and cooking tips from Chloe. And she has a killer waffle lecture or recipe, and you actually see Jay salivating and burping while this whole process is going on.
It's not literally killer. I'm still alive. It's killer in the good sense, right?
But I can see you salivating when you just even started.
I actually burped on the video.
So that was real. But yeah, optimizeforlife.org, and we plan on doing a lot more with it. And so that's the basis of our health ministry. And then Jay is a professor up at Northern Arizona University. And some of you local Verde Valley people, well, you know what Lisa and I do, we run this place, which is a personal training studio designed to put you through all sorts of fun, or at least our fun, and quite a few of you in here are clients of ours. It's not an open gym like a Snap Fitness, it's all personal training, so everything done A to Z. What I always tell people is we take all the guesswork out, we hold you accountable, and we push you a little harder, you push yourself, right?
Yes, that's for
all
sure.
Right. Okay. So, skeletal system.
We talked a little bit last night about the density of the bones. What'd you pick up on that? Any things that you can start doing right away to maintain or build bone density?
Exercise.
Okay.
Your soda.
Yeah.
Some soda, phosphoric acid in there. Okay, kind of leaches that calcium out of the bone, into the bloodstream and out into your urine. Okay, anything else?
Well, and I was asked to clarify a little bit more about weight-bearing exercise. Weight-bearing exercise is the weight training, because when you put pressure on the bones, because you have resistance on there, you're going to release ions and charges that are going to be pulling calcium into the bones. Also, anytime you put something like on your back, like if you squat with the weight on your back, that weight is really supercharging your spine and saying, well, we need to strengthen up here. You know, even astronauts that go into space start to decalcify and start to become osteoporotic. As soon as they get back on the ground, then they start recalcifying again. So every time you're working out, when we've got resistance in our hands, pushing, pulling, curling, whatever we're doing, that's going to be great. Working your legs, especially important, because the legs are the catalyst. And of course, Jay and I have been in weight rooms for all our lives, you know, basically. And how many guys did you see look like Tarzan up top and Jane down below?
Yeah.
You know?
The joke always is, isn't it leg day?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. That's for sure.
Now, hey, what about this, Dick? What about those that want to work out at home or with just their body weight? Could you do a personal session to give somebody a home program so if they didn't want to come in and...
I could, or also you could go onto YouTube and you can just put my name in, Dick Nunes, and you'll find over 300 videos that I've done on Body and Spirit, which is the online exercise show I've been doing on Worldwide Christian Broadcasting Network since 2001. And there's nothing more fancy than a towel and a chair. But yet, so often I've had people say, especially men will go, well, that looks easy, I could do that. And you know, while the wives are going through it, and the wives are finally go, try it. And they try it, and they go, well, that's hard. You know, so people find out you can get a good workout even if you're not using things. And like I told you the story about the 86-year-old woman who knocked out 18 push-ups. Yeah. That's how she got going. And one time I was in Hot Springs, Jay, which I know very near and dear place to you in South Dakota. And I was doing a talk, and last night I showed you how to squat properly. And I had the group get up and do squats. And this one lady just kept going up and down and up and down and hold. I was trying to break her. I couldn't. Yeah, she was just tough as nails. And she got up, and finally some of the people go, how'd you do that? She goes, I've been doing this show for years. And somebody said, how old are you? She said, 94.
Oh,
Mary Smith.
Yeah, Mary Smith. And she just absolutely obliterated the rest of the class. It's what?
So the thing about his program is you can adapt it to your level. You can go, you have modified ways to do it if you're just getting into it. Or you can do like Dick. I had Dick come to the college I taught at before I came here. He only lived 100 miles away. And he took the meanest, toughest guy who was kind of lipping off a little bit, but still wanted to kind of do a workout. He had him puking in, what, 15 minutes? So, I mean, you can do everything. You can adapt it for whatever you want to get out of it.
Okay? Now, but to be fair, yeah. I mean, Chris is one of my clients back here. Yeah. And you know, I got Ellen here and Lorna and Melissa's over here. And Lynn. Who else I've got? Oh, yeah. So, I've got a lot of clients here. And you've never felt like I'm just trying to break you, have you?
I've
never puked.
No.
Until you sign a check.
You know, I can't arrange for one of those workouts for you, so you can actually see what it's like. But it's funny, we have typically the men that will come through the door, they're not as willing to think that they need help as the women do, and you understand that. But we had a fireman come in here who's about my size, and I put him through. First I thought he was no way he's going to join, but I showed him a couple of exercises. He goes, wow, I want to learn more. So he started working out with us. And I just put him through his upper body workout yesterday. And after the upper body workout, and of course he wanted me just to drill him. Well, he goes, I think I'm getting sick. So he goes, down. And his wife just thinks it's hilarious. And she's taking pictures of him and stuff. She goes, you know, put it on your Facebook page. And I looked at the picture, Jay, and I kid you not, it looked like a face that you'd see in a morgue. And I said, I'm not going to put that on our Facebook page, you know. And of course, he did end up chucking and feeling very sick. And I said, look, I can tone it down. He goes, no, don't tone it down. Do not tone it down. Because he said, I realized, you know, as a fireman, that I need to work this hard in order to be prepared for my job. So, because he's a fireman down in Surprise. So, but we take it where people are at, even if it's just range of motion exercise.
Yeah.
You know, basically, if you have breath, you can actually, oh, and I forgot about John. John's in here. Yeah, he's one of my faithful clients. And so, you know, we just have a great, great crew of people. And it's a lot of fun.
The one thing about the muscle, we did the skeletal system, and then we went to the muscular system. And the one comment I'll remember Dick giving a lecture several years ago is that when you feel weak, you feel old. when you can't get out of chairs, when you can't weed your garden, when you can't do those daily activities that you used to do, it starts working on your mind. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing, the people would come through in an 18-day program that we worked at, they would come in with walkers and canes and things like that, and I always want to have a room on the first floor, there's two floors. And then one time you challenge, we didn't have any rooms on the first floor.
Right.
And we actually helped the lady get up to the second floor. And by the second week, we could hear running down the stairs. A lady in 2 weeks, 2 weeks into the program, was already going up and down the stairs and had a new lease on life just by strengthening, and obviously the other principles that we were teaching as well. But if you feel weak, you feel old.
Yeah.
And you lose your range of motion. You ever seen people drive down the road, just put on the blinker and go in the other lane?
Yeah, no kidding.
Because you lose your range of motion?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And who wants to lose their freedom of losing their car keys because of range of motion or muscle weakness?
And on the other hand, if you feel strong, you feel what?
Young.
Young.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You feel young. And that group you talked about, they were from Detroit.
Yeah.
I remember them well.
There's a group of them.
Yeah, they got out of their car and they're clip-hobble,
yeah.
You
yeah.
know. And like you said, they barely move.
It looked like a comedy act almost coming out of their car. They all had either some kind of crutch or some kind of walker.
Yeah.
Or...
I went to the airport to pick them up.
Yeah.
And I was waiting for them. And I go, they're not here. And all of a sudden, I see three wheelchairs coming my way.
Yeah.
I go, uh-oh. And I told them, I said, I didn't know we were all had rheumatoid arthritis rooms upstairs. But the one woman who was the worst, and she said our dining hall was 300 yards away, and it was downhill, uphill. And she said, I did not come here to ride in a vehicle, because we offered rides down to the main lodge for the meal. And she said, I didn't come here to ride in a vehicle, I came here to walk. And she goes, I don't care if it takes a half hour, I'm going to walk. And it did. It took her 40 minutes to get down there. And the other two women were taking rides. But every time they rode past her, it was screaming at them, get off your lazy ducks and walk as well. And this woman who was taking 40 minutes at the beginning of the program, within 2 weeks, it was only taking her 10. She knocked 30 minutes off her time.
Wow.
It was really amazing. And she inspired the other women to go to great heights, and they all got rid of their canes, all three of them. And we actually had a woman at the center too who had rheumatoid arthritis who hadn't walked in 9 months. And I was working with her so diligently, and people were joking that I was dancing with her, you know, because I'd get her up and I'd move her back and forth because I had to do whatever I could. And a lot of their staff didn't see what was going on. And so we always had a graduation, which was kind of the highlight of the program. People would share with it what took place. And so she was sitting about from me to you, Lynn, and I said, okay, next for the diploma, I called her name. She got up and walked up, and people went, people were gasping because they hadn't seen her walk yet. You know, all the staff had not seen her walk yet, and they were just absolutely shocked because this woman had not walked in 9 months because of rheumatoid arthritis.
Wow.
I guess the principle for me is that you can regain your strength.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
A little mindset, okay? Maybe a little assistance, maybe some support group. Maybe this could turn into some kind of support group too, outside of fit working out. Okay? So, we talked about the circulatory system. Okay? That's where the shower came in, right?
Right.
One of the things that you remember now, we're building up this plaque as we accumulate through the years. They actually did some autopsies on Korean War casualties, U.S. soldiers, 20, 21 years old, and they already had advanced development of atherosclerosis in 20 and 21-year-olds. Okay, so that's basically what we get in this country for living here. Other countries, when they when other people from other countries move here, they get the benefit of taking on our lifestyle diseases. Okay, we share that with them, and now we're exporting disease to other countries.
Yeah.
We're sending our fast food restaurants and our food to other countries, because that's where some of our, I'm not going to pick on any, I'm thinking of their logo in my head, I'm trying not to say it. Don't think of a white elephant, right? That's where the biggest market share is, and if you're an investor in those companies, maybe you're happy for that. Okay, you're getting dividends from certain companies, but we're exporting a lot of the foods here, even down just south of the border. Okay, so what else did we do? We did the break. Go ahead.
And what's sad part about that is I was just reading that again. The Okinawan grandparents are burying their grandchildren who are dying of lifestyle diseases.
Yeah. Oh. We talked about the Blue Zones last night. Anybody go on there today? BlueZones.com.
I checked it just before I came.
You checked it out, okay? You're seeing that the places in America, in the world, five zones where people are living to be 100 years old with vitality, that generation are called centenarians, okay, but their offsprings now, because we're exporting lifestyles to other, and the younger generations aren't picking up the lifestyle of the older people, that's what's happening now. The life expectancy is actually leveling off around the world of the next generation. Okay, we always expect to live longer and live longer than the previous generation. It's starting to level off now, and they're thinking it might even be tipping down, coming down to a shorter lifespan than we have right now.
And there's one woman who was 101, and she was so healthy and vibrant in her mind and body that they asked if she'd be willing to donate her brain to science. And her comment was, well, I'm not done with it yet.
But the interesting thing is some of us have become living organ donors. Somebody gave up their gallbladder already. Donated the gallbladder.
Yep.
Tonsils, I donated my tonsils like when I was 3 or 4 years old.
Yeah.
Adenoids, okay, appendectomy. Those are just extra point parts put in there by mistake, so you don't need those anyway.
No,
you're fine without them, okay? Your body adapts to some of that, but remember now, we're gonna get into the immune system tonight.
That's right, immune system.
Okay, now we're gonna get into the digestive system, one of Dick's favorite topics. Okay. So basically, how many of you have ever experienced heartburn? Just burning in the throat, burning in the chest, maybe you did something. We probably have all at one time or another had that. How many keep a fresh supply of Rolaids or Tums always nearby? How many are experiencing that on a regular basis right now? Anybody having regular, the technical term for it is GERD. Gastric stomach, okay? Esophagus, reflux, coming back up, disease. Okay, I actually have an uncle who actually died from that because we have this nice sensitive lining right here in this, what's this called right here?
Esophagus.
Well, that wasn't what my professor, my professor called that, an esophagus. He was from Asia. We used to stand out in the hallway and listen to him lecture to the next class too because it was so entertaining. I think when he came over here, they actually gave him hooked on phonics. Right over here, the esophagus. If there's a nice, fine, delicate lining right here, there's not a protective mucosal lining like the stomach, so that when we regurgitate that stomach acid in there, it burns, okay? And so what we're gonna look at tonight is how can we understand, and my theory behind health and wellness, I think this is the only thing I've added to science, okay? Is this saying, is cooperation with intended operation, okay? The body is intended to operate in a certain manner. A lot of times we force it to operate in an alternative manner, okay? So what we're trying to do is teach you anatomy and physiology, which is sometimes a scary thing, but basically it's no different than plumbing in a house. There's parts and there's functions. Parts are the anatomy, and the way it functions is the physiology. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So if we can cooperate with the way this was intended to operate, suddenly the GERD is going to disappear. I told you last night, is that amazing to you? I just wrote, I'm taking some classes right now from the U of A, and one of my reports was on GERD. And I actually found a study in there where it actually said that we spent $9 billion on Prilosec and all those different drugs, the purple pill, Nexium. We spend $9 billion with a B a year. That's not counting the over-the-counter drugs, which is $4 million. So, to just put out this fire. So why is that fire there? So let's take a look at the digestive tract and what's going on there. Did you know that we eat about 1,100 pounds of food per year, per person? 1,100 pounds, okay? Basically, the purpose of the digestive tract is to basically take the nutrients and liberate them out of the food. There's nutrients locked up in the food, and we're trying to liberate that. So Dick, talk a little bit about exercise and digestion.
One of the best things you can do after you have a meal is not laying down and taking a nap. In fact, that actually contributes to mental dullness. One of the best things you can do is get up and go out for an easy walk. You know, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which Jay and I are members of, they have, a lot of times they have potluck, which is today. And then the joke is they have lay activities afterwards, which means they go lay down and take a nap. But getting up and going for a walk is so beneficial because it stimulates digestive action, and not a hard walk, but an easy walk, and also the fact that your muscles are constantly looking for fats. Fats are the preferred fuel source of your muscles. And so when you go for a light walk, any overeating you might have done or compromising you might have done in your eating pattern, you can kind of compensate for that. Exercise is a great way to give yourself an insurance policy in case you do something that maybe you shouldn't have done. And also regular exercise, very beneficial for overall digestion. And another thing that I'd like to point out, Jay, you might hit on this a little bit yourself, is in the world of bodybuilding and so forth, or exercise, and even in diet, people are thinking they need to eat 7 times a day, 5, 6, 7 times a day. And I used to do that. I used to eat 7 times a day. And now I try and keep it at twice,
yeah,
or no more than 3.
Yeah.
So, and there's a lot of benefit to that. Do you want to touch on that?
Yeah. Okay, so let's take a little bit closer look here. Basically, the oral cavity, a lot of times we skip this right here and we try to wash it down with fluids. You ever done that? You ate food so fast that basically you passed right by the teeth. Okay.
Aren't there teeth down here?
There are no teeth in your stomach except for
crawdads.
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 Okay. We have a dentist back. There's no teeth in our stomach, is there, Jim?
Unless you accidentally swallow your dentures.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, we want it. And you know what? Where are your taste buds found? In your mouth, on your tongue. That's the only place. There are no taste buds in your throat, your neck, your stomach, your esophagus, anywhere. Okay. There are no taste buds after this. So my theory is that we eat so fast, and sometimes we're so distracted when we're eating, we don't realize what we're dumping in. And so a lot of times we'll put the bag of whatever out on the table, and we'll just eat out of the bag, or we'll be on the phone or something. Next thing we know, the bag's empty. Okay? So try to minimize the distractions while you're eating, and masticate, and let your taste buds have some fun. Okay? Once you let it go down the hatch here, you're not going to get any more satisfaction out of that.
And even if you're juicing or having a smoothie.
Yes. Swish it around.
Right.
Chew it. That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Good point. All right? So then once you go down into here.
Question
here.
Yeah.
No, I was just going to make a comment. My grandfather used to say chew it at least 100 times.
100 times.
100 times.
Wow.
Before
okay.
You swallow.
That's a little rough on oatmeal.
I never could do it.
It was a principle.
Yeah.
Now, when you get into the stomach here, there's different enzymes and things like that going on in here. But the stomach, now the acid is in there for a purpose, okay, to break down protein. Now, the reason acid's in there is not so we can have job and economic development, have rollades and tums being produced. Basically, you need that acid, okay, but we want it inside the stomach. Okay, so then we go down. So let's get into some principles that we can cooperate with here. So the digestive system is basically a series of organs here. So basically what we want to look at in here is that we want to understand the function of the digestive organs. Okay? And so what we want to do is make sure that we chew the food thoroughly. The more thoroughly you chew your food, the more absorption you're going to have as well when you break down those nutrients. Smaller particles, exactly. Okay? Importance of letting the stomach empty out and space the meals out. Remember now, your stomach actually has muscular lining. So when you're chewing that, you're actually lifting weights. Your stomach is actually contracting and relaxing the muscles. But I don't know if he'll let you get away with that as considered a weightlifting exercise eating.
Yesterday, you were telling me that the gluteus maximus was the strongest muscle. And I've heard that the jaw is the strongest muscle in the body.
It could be.
Well, I mean,
yeah.
I doubt that you can lift the weight with your jaw that you could with the gluteus maximus. The gluteus maximus are very large muscles. Very large muscles. And I know you had a thing on there that said the tongue was the strongest muscle in the body. I don't know if that was literal or figurative. But, you know, when you go into lifting weight,
yeah,
you know, just the extension of the hip. I mean, if we're talking about crocodile, then yeah, okay. But on a human being, I don't know that we could generate that much power in our jaw as we would with gluteus maximus. But okay.
So what is the importance, or are you going to get to that, of letting the stomach empty?
Okay.
Because I've heard...
Right. You know what the theory behind eating frequently is? Is to boost your metabolism.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if you're eating to boost your metabolism, that's like going and getting a loan to get a tax benefit.
That works, you know.
Does that make sense?
No.
Go in debt so you get a tax break.
No.
That's what eating extra calories into the body to boost the metabolism. The other thing is too, is would you want to boost your metabolism by eating food? Remember that if the higher your metabolism is also an aging mechanism in the body. So if we try to boost our metabolism by eating more food and the body's revving up, it's actually the aging process is accelerating.
Huh.
It doesn't that help you lose weight?
Okay, if you're looking at losing weight, why would you eat to lose weight?
Yeah.
Well,
no, I know that's what people say, but you have to kind of think through this logically a little bit. Eating to lose weight to boost the metabolism is like going in debt so you can get a tax break.
But that works, so you can't use that argument with me. I used to sell that plan.
What's that?
Sorry, so you're saying only eat two meals a day? Is that what you just said?
That's what I try to do now.
That's pissed.
Okay. So you guys think that you should actually go get a loan to go in debt?
I don't.
Anyway.
I'll talk to you later about that.
Okay. So some of you guys work at banks?
Banks wouldn't do that.
Okay. So basically what we're talking about is you eat the meal, chew the food thoroughly, let it digest and absorb, and let the stomach rest, because it is a muscle. Okay, let the meal empty out of the stomach until you eat the next meal. Because when you take food that's undigested and if you put fresh food, so to speak, into partially digested food, it slows down digestion and it all gets mixed together. So now you have putrefying food, fermenting food in your stomach mixed with new food coming in.
And that's why
you
have gas.
You start producing gases when you have undigested food that's sitting in there ready to almost go through, and then you bring in some new food, it all gets mixed together, and the hatches won't open up until it's all ready to go through, so it sits in there and you produce more and more acid, more and more acid, and when you're doing that, you start producing acid, and then you start producing from that, what do you get, gas? And then the gases in that chamber, it either has to go out the bottom or come out the top, the gas, okay? Has anybody ever had that happen, ever produced gas?
Oh my God.
I take that as a yes.
And remember, either release it here and you belch it, or you go to the other end and they call it flatulence.
Right.
Nice fancy term. Yeah.
Can you address the reason that they have you eat more frequent meals is to activate or unactivate a hormone that makes you store fat rather than using it for energy? Theoretically, that's what I've read. So why, what do you do to, if you're not going to eat more meals and smaller meals and do that, what do you do to optimize the hormone, whatever that is, that causes
you? Are you talking about leptin and ghrelin?
Yes.
Okay, basically when you eat the foods that we're talking, it's a type of food you're eating too. If you're eating processed, highly processed foods, it's going to go through faster and you're not going to eat a lot of fiber. Okay, the food's going to go through and you are going to be hungry again. But when you adopt the foods that we talked about last night, where you're eating at least 35 grams of fiber a day, you're not going to be able to eat more than three meals a day, unless you're stuffing yourself.
But the hormone is what I'm talking about. It's not so much being hungry.
It's the quantity. There's also stretch receptors in your stomach that actually work with the leptin.
Okay.
And shuts off that hormone and says, I'm hungry. Okay, so if you do a lot of liquid foods or foods that don't have bulk in them, your stretch receptors in your stomach are not going to be stretching and giving you that satisfaction, shutting off the leptin hormone that's telling you to eat, eat, eat.
Okay.
The leptin hormone that you produce in the body is a hunger hormone, so you actually eat, and it shuts it off when the stretch receptors in the stomach get to a certain level.
And some of these processes she's referring to are temporary adjustments of the body to deal with what's happening. But as you know, the body adjusts very easily and goes, okay, we understand what's going on now, and that very process she's talking about will start to slow down. You know, just like somebody has a gastric bypass, they lose weight right away. But after a while, the body goes, okay, we're adjusting to this, and now the person can hardly eat anything, and they'll actually start gaining weight again. But I'd like to interject something about the empty stomach thing. Loma Linda, which Jay's made reference to, Loma Linda Hospital, took nurses and fed them at 8, noon, and 6, and gave them 2 bites of chocolate at 10 and at 3. Checked the contents of the stomach that night at 8:30, and on the average, half the breakfast was still in the stomach undigested. And the next morning, some of the previous morning's breakfast was still in some of their stomachs. The longer food stays in your stomach, the more problems you're going to have, both storing fat and also the immune problems, the autoimmune disorders we battle, and so on and so forth. It just isn't worth it. And so, so many of these programs that are out there, they're designed to make money. They just are. There's always some little gadget out there. In the exercise world, we did PE classes back in the 70s. Some of you in my age category remember that? And now we've repackaged them and we call them P90X and insanity. Yeah, well, yeah, kind of, but they're just nothing but glorified PE classes. It's all designed for people because they just want to make money and try and do things. But here's the bottom line. If you look at the cultures, the blue zone cultures that Jay's talking about, what kind of diets did they have? They weren't eating all day long. They have two or three meals of healthy food, regular movement throughout the day. And that's what makes people healthy. And that's the bottom line. Because they study cultures and they see that as a consistency, whether it's the Hunzas or some other, or the Okinawans or other groups that I can't pronounce their names.
So do you advocate food combining in order to combat that food staying in the stomach and fermenting? Because food combining actually says don't eat this with that and don't eat that with that. You know, don't add meat and potatoes together.
You know, you have actually, this, your stomach is a distillery. Okay, if you want to really make some good moonshine, milk, eggs, and sugar together, and then throw a little bit of apple pie on top of it.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, you can really get some nice, you know, cook up some good gas in there, putrefaction a little bit there. You can, you know, you can actually have a little toot storm, you know, going on. And so,
that actually killed my dad. He would have sugar and milk every night before bed.
Yeah.
And when he was about 65 years old, the doctor said, Mr. Nunez, you're developing cirrhosis of the liver. You need to quit drinking.
Yeah.
He wasn't drinking. He was having sugar and alcohol every night.
Yeah.
Or sugar and milk every night, which forms alcohol. And then, you know, towards the end of his life, he ended up dying of total liver failure.
Right.
Cirrhosis of the liver turned yellow, lost a bunch of weight. And it was the last time I saw him, and he wanted a piece of custard pie before he went to bed. My mom goes, what do you think I should do? And I said, a little late now. Yeah. Let him have his pie.
Non-fatty liver is what it's called, you know.
Yeah.
Basically. And so what do we see a lot of times? I grew up in a house with an alcoholic. You take away the alcohol, what do they go to?
Sugar.
Right. And so you get your fix in the brain and in the body by substituting and making your own alcohol in a little distiller right here in your stomach.
Yeah, even in AA, the book, they say that they found that one of the good substitutes is sugar.
Yeah.
Alcoholics, they're trying to put.
Yeah, cigarettes, coffee, and some sugar. Yes. So basically, they take one addiction and substitute it with another one.
Yeah, and I don't think they were aware at that time, you know, why it was good.
I've been to plenty of AA meetings and it's the cloud in there and the sweets and the coffee. Okay? Anyway, so we're getting off track a little bit. Okay? It's all good though. So basically then the other thing we want to do is the way that you can force yourself to chew more thoroughly is to minimize the amount of liquids you're drinking with your meal. Because the more liquids you drink with your meal, you're also going to neutralize the acid in the stomach, and then the stomach has to build back up to a certain pH level, and then to build it up in there and then produce more and more acid, we keep putting more liquid in there, neutralizing the acid. The food's going to sit in the stomach longer.
That was my other question from last night.
After you get done eating?
Pardon me?
You're all done eating, and then you drink a glass of, say, milk.
Let the system digest some of that food that you should basically work. Wait for at least a half hour to an hour.
Okay.
Have your liquids between your meals, not with your meals.
I always drink a glass of almond milk.
Yeah.
With my meal.
Okay.
After I'm done eating, not when I'm eating.
Again, it's still going to go in there and basically dilute the acids, but it also forces you to chew your food more thoroughly if you minimize the liquids. Okay. Other things. Better move on. Got that?
Yes.
Okay, so you chew your food thoroughly, spread your meals out, eat plenty of fiber so you're not hungry between meals. You'd be amazed how many people used to come to our program when we'd serve them two or three meals and they'd think, oh my goodness. Because, you know, think about this, in America, we're never more than 10 to 15 feet from food.
Yeah.
Somebody's going to go for a walk to the end of the block, oh, I better take a snack with me. You know, like, whoa, you might get, you know, kidnapped or something down there. And then, but we have food stashed in our glove boxes or everywhere. We were food everywhere. We're food junkies, okay? And most of it's processed junk that we're carrying around if we have it in those places, unless you're taking whole food or something.
And here's something interesting. Yeah. When we tell our wellness guests that they're only going to have two meals, which ones do you think were the most concerned about starving to death? The ones that are underweight or the ones that are overweight? The ones that are overweight. They're afraid they're going to starve to death. And so, of course, we were in the Black Hills, which is Old West territory, you know, Wild Bill Hickok and all that stuff. So some of the guests would leave the dining hall, and they looked like they had their 2 6 guns in their pocket. You know, they had a banana in each pocket as they're walking back to the hill. So you're trying to get across them, you know, this isn't snacky time, you know. There's no gunfight at the OK Corral. So.
Okay, let's talk about the endocrine system. What do we need to know about that, Nick?
Well, endocrine system is a very important area, and we don't realize how vital this is and what can happen to us as we get older and if we don't take care of ourselves. Now, a lot of people say they have glandular problems. They'll be speaking of the thyroid gland or some of the other, the renal, pancreas, or whatever, when the reality is they do have glandular problems with their salivary gland problems because of what they want to eat and so forth. But what we eat definitely affects these things. They will affect your overall health. There are hormones produced throughout the body. One of the things that's very crucial is the cortisol level. If your cortisol level is elevated, you can have a lot of problems. And certainly lifestyle is very key to keeping those down. And then you were going to mention a little bit about the visceral?
We will. Okay, so the endocrine systems basically produce hormones. And what do hormones do? They turn off and shut down different systems, okay, or processes in the body. So this whole endocrine system's releasing hormones and trying to balance out to what we call homeostasis, okay? Now, one thing we want to look at is, let's go back to this right here. There's different types of body fat, Nick, right? There's this pinch and inch stuff. Okay, can you guys pinch an inch? Or a couple inches? Or a couple of yardsticks? Okay? Basically, that little bit of fat that you can pinch, you know what that's called? It's called subcutaneous fat. Subcutaneous, like a submarine, just underneath the surface.
Look at this.
Okay? That can actually be beneficial.
This?
Subcutaneous. That's a muscle. Okay? So we have this basically, and that basically insulates the body, cushions the organs and so forth. But there's something else that gets inside close to the organs. And in the last few years, we're starting to realize now that the fat tissue is actually an endocrine gland. And we have what's called visceral fat, which is visceral means right around the organs. Okay? How many of you have an uncle who basically always, when you were a kid, said, come on, punch me in the stomach right there, and you'd punch him, and as hard as a rock, he says, yeah, that's muscle. Right? He's got the big belly and the little skinny butt. Right? And his navel's pointing down to the ground. Right? That hard belly, that's visceral fat that's packaged right around the organs. This is basically a time bomb. Okay? If you tend to store fat above your belt as a below your belt, now ladies, you're kind of blessed in that. Okay? I know you guys don't like the hips or things like that. That's actually protective fat. When you have the subcutaneous fat below the belt, if you tend to store your fat when you gain weight, if I start gaining weight and overeating and things like that, quit working out, I'll start gaining it in the belly, and that's the most dangerous fat in the body, and that's now considered, this is recent discoveries, that they're considering this as metabolically active to the point of, check this out, body fat or adipose tissue, now we used to think it was just a storage place to basically go, it's like an extra gas tank. You ever drive a motorcycle and you have that reserve tank? Okay? We have those reserve tanks, and the body's very efficient at adding on extra rooms if you need it. So we can actually add a bedroom over here, maybe a dining room over here. The body will do that. Okay? But check this out. One of the most important developments since the mid-90s is the realization that the fat cell is an endocrine organ secreting hormones and other molecules that have far-reaching effects on other tissues. So it basically releases fat directly into the bloodstream, triglycerides, and also LDL cholesterol that actually leads to heart attacks and strokes.
One of the things that'll do for women, as they gain more body fat, it will make them, you know, take the male hormones, the androgens that come into their body, that are produced in the body, and turn them into estrogens. So their estrogen levels become too elevated, which causes risk factors for breast cancer, uterine cancer, period problems, so on and so forth. So having those hormones balanced. And of course, for men, the testosterone. As they get older, if they're not taking care of themselves and being too overweight, their testosterone levels start to drop. And again, that also is affected by elevated cortisol levels. So, very important.
Is this making sense? This is the endocrine system talking about the different hormones, okay? Whether it's women, estrogen, men, testosterone, those types of things. Talking about body fat, okay? So let's talk about what we can do, daily habits.
Before we get on to that.
But that was interesting about that, about the inflammation.
Yeah.
The last one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you, where is that?
Visceral fat makes more of the proteins called cytokines.
Yeah.
Okay, which triggers low level inflammation, which causes your arteries to narrow. Okay, so you have, again, what's that gonna do? Raise your blood pressure,
yeah.
Put more stress on your vascular system.
Right.
Okay?
And what's the number one hormone-related disease that we know of? Carol, I bet you know this one.
Diabetes.
Diabetes. Diabetes, you know, because insulin is a hormone. And very reversible. Type 2 diabetes is so reversible. Hypertension is so reversible. So many of these things.
We look at these things and we in a sense, look at them as that's not a real problem because we've seen literally in 2 weeks' time, people basically get rid of medications they've been on for years and years under physician care,
right.
Supervision, gradually back them off following this lifestyle. Leave this lifestyle, comes back.
Yeah,
and that lifestyle disease comes back.
And that goes back to a very important point. A lot of times people change their lifestyle. They say, I'm cured.
Yeah.
So, no, you're not cured. You're controlling
yes.
your problem with lifestyle. If you're cured, you can go back and eat however you want, and you're still gonna be okay. But when you change your lifestyle, it's like you're cured, as long as you stay with the lifestyle. And so when people would come to the wellness program in the Black Hills, and we would do screening, you'd have to say, well, we got good news and bad news. Well, what's the bad news? Well, you have diabetes. Oh no, well, what's the good news? Came to the right place, because we'll reverse it within a couple weeks.
So why don't you talk about, Dick, how can people get their cortisol levels down or managing them or keep them down?
Well, I did have a question. I'm a little off the subject. The morbidly obese, I used to watch the 600-pound body, you know, with the gastric bypass and stuff like that. What is it in their brain that makes them continually eat and not be satiated? Is there something?
Some of it might be linked back to the hormones, the leptin hormone, the hunger hormone being shut off. There may be a dysfunction there.
Yeah.
Okay, they may actually may even have a hormone deficiency there. So they may have to have injected hormones to actually shut off the appetite.
Oh, okay.
That's one aspect. It could be psychological things too.
Yeah.
It's funny, I ran into a guy on an airplane and told me that his hormonal system had been damaged to the point where he no longer knew whether he was hungry or not.
That can happen.
He was still overweight because he was scared he was going to be starving himself to death, so he ate twice as much as he should have.
No. Was it a good solution? cortisol.
Cortisol.
Yeah. Well, first of all, stay in the green section of the sheet that Jay gave you. That will help immensely. Regular exercise, both cardiovascular, doing some walking or whatever, swimming, jogging, cycling, cardio machines. Doing the lifting, all those things will help immensely to help your cortisol levels. Getting adequate sleep, very, very important. That's one thing that I battled for a long time in my life. I just wouldn't sleep. And since I moved to Camp Verde, it's changed a lot.
Yeah,
you know?
Me too.
And my wife has noticed a lot of differences in me since I've been sleeping more.
And so
it really, really helps. And then also keeping your mind from things you can't control. I mean, so often, how often do we wake up and we start thinking about something and you know, and Lisa and I do this to each other. There's times I'll say, Lisa, you're not going to solve it at 1 o'clock in the morning, you know, and she'll say the same thing to me because we'll tend to sit there and start dwelling on things that we can do nothing about, or we start worrying about what might happen when we don't know what's going to happen. And so all those things, the stress, the worry, lack of sleep, bad diet, all those things are going to raise your cortisol levels. High animal products definitely is going to raise that cortisol level and it's going to start causing problems in the hormones.
Okay, now I've heard this a lot of times, Dick. People say, I don't like to sweat when I exercise. So why do we put up here that exercise to perspiration? What's going on physiologically when you sweat?
Well, here's the reality. Well, sweating is a cooling mechanism.
Right.
And especially here in Arizona, when we stopped off at Lynn's today to go let her dogs out, and we start sweating, you know, just being outside. Can't help it. It's a cooling mechanism. If you didn't sweat, you'd have real problems. But actually, sweating does feel good. Women, the old thing, men sweat, women glow, or whatever nonsense that is. That still goes back to the sugar and spice and everything nice theory. And, you know, boys are made out of whales and snails and puppy dog tails and things. Yeah. You know, we guys got a bad rap. But anyhow, but women, the more fit you become, the more easily you'll perspire. But here's the thing. The more fit you become, the more you'll have to do to get you to perspire. So in other words, if we went out for a walk around the building, some of you would probably start perspiring heavily because it's hard. We probably wouldn't because it's not that hard for us. But once we get into our working mode, Jay's an avid runner. He likes to run, you know, 5-6 miles. But once he gets into his running mode, you start to perspire very effectively. And that will help you cleanse the body. And you want to do that. Cleansing, that's very important for you.
Well, what about a sauna?
Saunas are good. Infrared.
I know.
Yeah, infrared saunas are very good. Yeah. I don't like them, but.
I love them.
That's great, you know. But I work out like a crazy man, too, you know. So that kind of does my thing. You know, Lisa doesn't sweat as easily as I do. So she does the infrared a little bit more than I do. And for other health reasons where some of the things that she deals with, I don't. So I get a pretty good load on my exercise. So, okay.
What about the respiratory system? Want to give us an introduction there, Dick?
Well, again, it's something that respiratory system is something we kind of take for granted until we start losing it, and then we don't take it for granted anymore. Nobody wants to gasp for breath, and of course, it's a very intricate system as well with the lungs and exchanging of oxygen and oxygenating the blood. And so many of us are aware of sinus problems, the nasal cavity. I know when I was young, I mentioned before that I used to drink a gallon of milk a day, and I'm lactose intolerant. And when you're lactose intolerant, it makes it very rough trying to sleep. And so I had to use nasal spray every night when I slept, when I was in college and so forth. Always had to use nasal spray because I'd always get stuffed up. When I stopped drinking milk and using dairy products, all of a sudden I didn't need nasal spray anymore. So we get congestion and so forth, and so many of the things we do to ourselves are reactions to that. And here's something that is very important. I mentioned yesterday about taking cholesterol medications and it's just a bandage. Here's something that happens when somebody breathes in pollen. Some people, and this is gonna kind of tie over to the immune system as well, people will breathe in and that pollen creates problems. Now it does it for everybody, but for some people, the mast cells of the lungs release histidine, which produces histamine, and it sets up a mucosal bath in the sinus cavity. And so that way you can't breathe in real well, but if you do breathe in, things get trapped in that mucosal lining, and you blow it out, and of course it doesn't get into your system to harm you. But what do we do when we start having a histamine release and it's causing the congestion? What do we take? Antihistamine. Now, as soon as you use the word anti, what does that sound like?
Against.
Antihistamine. You know, antibody, you know, all this thing, what people do to themselves. But antihistamines, actually antibodies are good because they're part of your immune system, but antihistamines will suppress the release of histamine, and so now you can breathe, but what are you doing? Now you're breathing the very things in that your body doesn't want in. And it starts compromising your immune system. And people start to wonder why they start to hurt or have all these problems. The chronic fatigues, the fibromyalgia. And again, fibromyalgia is so reversible. And you hear people suffer with 20, 30 years. And in 3 weeks, you can totally turn them around. They're like a new person. They don't have it anymore.
How do you do that when they haven't even defined what it is?
Well, they haven't defined what fibromyalgia
is.
It's a nondescript irritation that's caused from an autoimmune response where the body's fighting against itself.
Mm-hmm.
So autoimmune disorders are very real because rheumatoid arthritis is just that.
Right.
It's an autoimmune disorder. Body's fighting against itself. You know, inflammation is something that is in the body for a purpose. But we take anti-inflammatories to get the information away that we go about doing the things we want to do, but the body's going, ouch, you know, I didn't want that. I mean, how many times have you known of in athletics, like in football and so forth, somebody tears up their knee and they go in at halftime and all of a sudden they come back out and they're ready to play again. Well, what do they do to them at halftime?
Shoot them up with steroids.
They injected them with stuff so they don't feel the pain anymore. But what is it doing to them in the long run? You know, so we put Band-Aids on a lot of things. You know, the worst thing you can do when you have a fever is take aspirin to bring the fever down. The fever's there for a reason. But we're constantly treating symptoms instead of treating the condition and why is the fever there, what's there to make your body an inhospitable environment for the antigen that's invading it to help your immune system response to get rid of it. You know, so all these things that are taking place, very important. And a lot of things that you're sensitive to are going to be found in the respiratory system because that's one of the places where we see the results of allergic reactions.
Dick, what about osteoarthritis?
Osteoarthritis is a bone-on-bone. It's not an autoimmune disorder. It's just, if we all live long enough, we tend to get a little bit of osteoarthritis. I've got some. I'm guessing Jay does because he was a hockey player. But I can't help but have a little bit somewhere. You know, a little joint that might hurt just a little bit every now and then. You get a little bit of grinding and, you know, I always tell people our injuries of our youth become the arthritis of our older years, you know. You see a football player again and you see him get smashed to the ground and he bounces back up and he runs back to the huddle. Well, we're thinking, oh, wow, he's tough. But the reality is that hit, you can only take so many of those in your life before it starts to cause problems. So that osteoarthritis can greatly be alleviated through proper lifestyle, or it can be, and through exercise, strengthening muscles. And the orthopedic surgeon, the same one who diagnosed my knee, he always, his comment goes, you could add another 50,000 miles with exercise to your joint. You can add another 100,000 miles if you change your eating habits as well.
Okay, my chiropractor always said motion is lotion.
Yeah. Okay, so think about this. So your whole vascular system, your whole respiratory system also has muscular linings. Okay, right. So exercise is going to help with your breathing, being more efficient. Again, talking about proper posture, sitting and standing, your respiratory sitting over, hunched over. We do that in cars. We do that at home all the time. We stand, we slouch. Okay, so you want to stand upright, get more erect. Again, the clothing, tight bands. Okay, we quit wearing the corsets, right? That's a good thing. And those types of things. Sunlight exposure, ventilation of buildings. You know, sometimes we make our buildings now so airtight that we're locking in toxins and we're not getting air exchange in there. Okay, so it'd be nice to get the air exchanged in the system. And also, again, the contrast showers. I had to throw that in there again for you. The cold showers, okay, for helping you with your respiration and getting your circulation going.
Well, you suck
in. Okay, yeah, definitely. So our last one is going to be the immune system. Okay, you think of your basically your security system. If you have a camera on your house or some kind of alarm, or maybe you think of police or things like that. That's what the immune system is doing for the body. Why don't you give us an intro on that?
The immune system is huge. It's and we mentioned earlier about the tonsils and the appendix, and a lot of people think those are worthless appendages that were just a mistake. Well, the reality are they're aggregates of T lymphocytes. The first one to help the digestive tract down this way, and the other one to help the other end of that digestive system. And so, you know, cancer of the colon and so on goes up quite a bit when you get rid of the appendix, because that was your last line of defense of aggregates of T lymphocytes. So your immune system is so grossly affected. I mean, we've all seen the old statistic about the more sugar you have, the lower the ability of body to take out bacteria. And so it's very real. So many of you know that you take in a bunch of sugar and so forth, and that's when you start getting sick. When you're under a lot of stress, that compromises your immune system. And the beauty of the immune system is there's so many great things we can do to boost it. And I know back in my early days, Jay, when I was doing the 3 pounds of meat, gallon of milk, half dozen eggs every day, I had to worry about infections all the time. If I cut myself, I always had to worry about secondary infections. One time when I was in college, I had a strep infection and a staph infection in my throat at the same time.
Ooh.
Yeah, I just always had to worry about nooses. But I was big and powerful. You know, I was 255 pounds, and I was bench pressing 455 and squatting almost 700. I was big and powerful, but my blood pressure was high. My cholesterol was high. I started losing my hair when I was 18 years old. I mean, you know, I was having all sorts of problems. Fortunately, most of the things are reversed. Most of them.
Number five, is that regular massages?
What's that?
Number five, regular massage. Is that messages. Supposed to be regular massages?
Messages.
What kind of messages?
massages. It's a typo.
Okay, because I'm wondering.
Positive messages.
Messages. You know, put positive in front of that.
Yeah. You know, if this was a room full of men, we never would have to worry about that.
I want you to get what Dick said, though, about the immune system responding to processed sugars.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? With one heavy dose at a meal, you can, in a sense, check your immune system on for 6 hours. Okay? It's documented in the scientific literature.
I'll tell you, I've been eating very good, and then I started drinking alcohol, sake, things like that, because we had company. Every day for a week, within a week, I was sick, and I was sick for 2.5 months.
Wow. And
it had to be that, because it was the only thing I changed. So I got a bug, and I went, I'm done.
And there are so many people who have had critical diseases. And I'm talking about stage 4 cancer. And by getting on a lifestyle program where they get their immune system kicked back into gear, awesome things have happened. And here's the harsh reality. The typical treatment of cancer in our society is not a victory on the war of cancer. It doesn't. And what it does, of course, is it wipes out the immune system. So.
Okay, so these are some things you can do on a daily basis. Think about how your immune system is going to be built up. If you didn't get one of these last night, stop and get one tonight. These foods, again, on the left-hand side are going to be your immune system-building foods. Okay, how else are your cells in your body, including your immune system, going to get the material to make good immune system cells? Okay, basically from the food we eat. So over here, again, the green leafy vegetables are going to be the highest and the best for building the immunity. And these other foods, berries, again, G-bombs.
Yeah, okay? Tell us what all those initials stand for again, because I missed some of them.
Greens is the G.
Let's see if the class knows.
Okay, greens, what's the B?
Beans.
Mushrooms.
Onions. Mushrooms.
Berries.
Seeds.
And nuts.
And
then what's the
and
G?
Tomatoes.
Tomatoes. Now, if you can't handle those foods or you don't want to eat some of those foods in there, that's the neat thing about nutrition. There's no single food you have to eat. You can get those nutrients from another food. So last night we had an individual that was here who couldn't do beans. Okay, so substitute something else in there. There's no single food that you have to eat. Even though kale is 1,000 points on the Andy score. And if you don't like it, don't eat it. Eat spinach. Eat romaine. Okay, and then eat a variety of foods. You know, the average person eats about 12 to 15 foods and just rotates them, but the average woman has 25 cookbooks. Okay? Which reminds me, we brought 3 cookbooks tonight. Okay. How are we going to do that drawing? We're going to do a drawing at the end. Okay, anyway, exercise. How does the exercise improve the immune response?
It's sort of cholesterol, things like that.
How are we going to boost the immune system? With exercise.
Well, it circulates the blood. The blood takes oxygenates everything, and it takes the waste away.
I was still thinking about how we're going to get the cookbooks.
I'm sure there's a cookbook deficiency in this crowd. Right? There isn't enough cookbooks in the world, so my wife and I had to put another one together. There's not enough cookbooks out there. That's we need a cookbook exchange. It'd be like you got 25 new ones in the
room. I wasted so much money on coconut and almond flour because I can't find a way to make it work.
Oh, I have a cookbook for that.
Okay, let's go on the exercise. They did some studying on men with prostate cancer and so on and so forth. They had them do a half-hour bike ride. And it was dramatic to see the reduction. Prostate cancer will not grow in the environment set up after exercise. And so when people come in here to work out, And granted, not everybody loves to work out, I got that. But a lot of people who don't like to exercise will come in here and they'll go through their workout. And how do you feel after your workout?
Great.
Okay, so when you feel great, what chemicals are being produced?
Endorphins.
Endorphins have a great immune response. When you have negative thoughts, when you have adrenaline, noradrenaline, all those things, then you're going to have decreased health and decreased immune system. And so when you work out, it gives you this feeling of well-being, and it also stimulates circulatory response. It also opens up pathways. You know, like if you look at my arms, you see I have a lot of blood vessels on my arms. Because you require a lot of circulation as you work out. And so the body's gonna be opening up new pathways. So, very important, it's gonna give you that feeling of well-being, it'll help you rest better. Our body's designed to move, okay?
Okay, so we're gonna try to summarize, and from my standpoint, from the nutrition standpoint, these are the two things that you wanna start focusing on. Minimizing or eliminating processed foods.
Now,
things that come in packages.
Processed food, would that be like the amazing grass that I get, the Arbonne protein powder, the things like that? Are you classifying that in the processed food?
I can't think of a more processed food than certain protein powders.
Okay.
If they're isolated whey proteins and there's different things like that.
This is all vegetable proteins.
If it's all like dehydrated foods put into a powder, that's a different situation.
Right, that's what it is.
Okay.
Super grains and things like that.
Yeah. So if those are different. Dehydrated grass juice coming out of there.
Okay.
But the other thing we want to look at is basically the more we touch it as a human being, okay? What I'm talking about is getting whole foods right out of the ground, off the trees, off the vine, and eating them in as least preparation and cutting and dicing and chopping them as possible. Okay? You have to get them where they're appetizing and appealing. The other thing is minimizing how much animal protein. Animal protein is one of the most turn off and on cancer genes in the body. Okay? We've seen this with the China study with Colin Campbell from Cornell University. Went over and studied all these different regions in China. Because the Chinese emperor had cancer, so they started looking at it, and basically they could turn on and off cancer genes with milk protein. Okay, so guys with prostate, living with breast cancer, things like that, the animal protein cancer risk goes up proportionately with the more animal protein, especially dairy products.
Homocysteine rate goes up.
Homocysteine, C-reactive protein, all those go up, IGF-1, and some like growth factor, that's all kind of technical jargon.
Now, homocysteine is amino acid.
Right.
And that's an animal product.
Right.
And so when you eat more of that, that homocysteine rate is going to go up.
You also produce it in your body.
Yeah, right.
So you don't need more.
And that's going to increase your risk factors for really bad diseases.
Correct. So the two things you work on is minimizing or eliminating the animal protein in the processed foods. That's the double whammy in the nutrition, if I could just summarize it in 2 points.
Hamburger helper.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Growing up, I was born in 1950, that dates me, I don't know, but it was wheat, milk, fruits, vegetables, and bread.
Four food groups.
And they pounded that into our heads.
And who set it up?
National Dairy Council.
And think about this. I grew up on a half a gallon to a gallon of milk a day. Okay, I had ice cream before I went to bed. All those things.
Us too.
Okay? That's just what we did.
But we were younger then.
Yeah.
And we could burn it off.
Okay, but the thing to think about it is which mammal consumes mammary milk after they've been weaned?
Not man.
Only the human. And then we go and steal it from another mammal.
Right.
Right? Get a picture of that. You're out in the field drinking off the cow.
And not that, but we're taking milk from an animal designed to weigh 1,000 pounds, 2,000 pounds,
and with seven stomachs.
And when you accelerate that process with a high protein diet, when you put in a lot of high protein foods in your body, you accelerate the aging process and you speed up all the different tissue growth, all the negative stuff too. Okay, so if you got a young athlete that's trying to bulk up, yeah, they'll get big like Dick was. Okay, but they're also going to have hair falling out and all this, whoops. Yeah. All those other issues, that you have that come with that. So the high protein diet is basically counterproductive if you're looking at it from a health perspective.
Whether it's vegetable or animal.
Correct.
Okay.
Now, if it's whole plant foods, it's one thing. Now, even if some people say, well, I'm going to quit eating this, I'm going to go eat these things they call veggie links and veggie meats and things like that, just as bad.
Yeah.
Okay? They raise the IGF, the cancer-causing proteins in the body, to go up as well because they're isolated soy protein. They've taken them out of their natural state, and they give you a very concentrated part, and it basically has this, you can't tell physiologically if you're eating animal protein or plant protein when you isolate the soy protein in there. But now, if you went and got the whole soy or you got the whole bean, different story. It doesn't set you up for those different types of cancers and things like that. Okay, so the main thing is think about the way we used to eat when we didn't have fast food and all these things. Go back to simple cooking. Okay? Exercise. What's the takeaway message? This is the takeaway message for nutrition. What is it for exercise?
Well, well, again, you know, the exercise, as I mentioned before, is going to give you the mental approach. It's going to help you rest. And that 7 to 9 hours of sleep is so important for a healthy immune system. And getting a lot of water, keeping your body flushed, because a lot of people go around dehydrated. And the vital organs, your liver, which has so many functions, needs to have the ability to flush the toxins out of the body, because that's its function. It sends the waste byproducts to the kidneys and flushes it out. So all of your systems will work much more effectively. Your body will be thanking you, because here's the beauty of the body. It's constantly changing. Cells are constantly turning over. They're dying and replacing. So, you know, the whole thing where you'll have a new stomach lining in 5 days and new bones in, I don't know, a year or something like that. But, you know, talking about the entire body, 99% of the cells are replaced, like in a year's time. So what fuel are you giving yourself to do that? And, you know, the standard line I've used so many times is people, if you gave them a classic car, their dreams, for free, how are they going to take care of it? They're going to keep the oil changed, they're going to keep the filters changed, because it's valuable. But they'll take better care of that car than they will their own body. You know, the body, I mean, you can replace the car. You can't replace your body. But we also know if you keep premium fuel in your body and keep the filters clean, it's going to perform better just like a car will. So very important to keep that in mind. It's really quite simple, but yet it can be complicated as well. So that was our whole purpose here, is take these systems and give you a little education about how they work, and then also talk to you about what causes them to go bad and what we can do to reverse them. And that's the beauty of every system we've talked about can be improved upon. Every system. And that's what Optimize for Life is all about.
Okay. Who didn't get a hand up from last night? Any charts? Questions? We can. We're hoping the ladies figured out how to do a drawing for. We're trying to figure out if the ladies have a way of doing the door prizes.
Did you cast that on them?
They're doing it already.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we need just a couple minutes. Any questions? Go ahead.
Can I just get an extra sheet?
Yeah.
For my...
I have a question. What do you think of an inverter?
Inversion table?
Yeah.
Fine. It's just a stretching mechanism. You know, so many of the things out there will not be a cure-all in themselves. Because even if you do an inverted table and you stretch the spine or whatever, you still need to do the exercises that will help keep the body in proper alignment and so on and so forth. You know, the simple thing is when you go into a chiropractor, say, and they, you know, make your joint pop, what's happening there? Well, you have synovial gas in the joint and it's causing a release of that, but it causes a temporary anesthetic effect and makes the muscles around the vertebral column relax. Now, there are different ways